That was nice. It all went quiet. Well, good morning, everybody. Whether you're here in person or watching us online, a really warm welcome to our worship here at St. John's this morning. My name is Barbara Wilson. I'm the assistant minister here, and Sue, our licensed lay minister, will be preaching later on. We're continuing our series on marks of mission, and today we're looking at teach, baptize, nurture. And some words from the second reading that we have, the first reading we're having from Matthew today, says this: Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him. That was the effect of seeing Jesus, to worship. And so that is where we begin our service today, in worship, with this hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, and we stand to sing. Sit down. That hymn reminds us of just how holy God is. Holy, holy, holy. Three times we've sung that at the beginning of each verse. And it's reminded us that he is perfect in power, love, and purity. And we know that we are not pure. And so we come to God, to this holy person, with our need to ask for his forgiveness. Let's take a moment to be quiet and think of those places and those times when we have not lived up to that holy expectation, because we can't. but also to ask for his forgiveness. And so we say together, most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with all our heart. We have not loved you, neighbours, as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the Father of all mercy cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And a special prayer for today. Lord, you have taught us that all our doings without love are nothing worth. Send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love, the true bond of peace and of all virtues, without which whoever lives is counted dead before you. Grant this for your only Son, Jesus Christ's sake, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. But just a few notices. I haven't actually consulted with anybody else about these, so I'm hoping I've got the ones that I need to do. Next Saturday at 2:30 is Mark's ordination at Blackburn Cathedral. I suspect all the tickets have gone for that now, have they? There's room for one or two more if you would like to go. Please remember Mark and his family this week. Mark will be off on retreat from Wednesday, a chance to be quiet away from the hustle and bustle and focus his mind. Then on Tuesday, not this Tuesday, but the following Tuesday at 1:00, there is a deanery service of farewell for Bishop Julian. He's going round all the deaneries in the diocese over the next few weeks. He'll be exhausted, I think, by the end of that. And it's at St. James's Church, and all are welcome to that. Be our chance in a smaller group to actually say our farewells to Bishop Julian, who has made a huge difference to this diocese. And then on Wednesday that week, at 7:30, the One Voice Choir are giving us an evening of music and song at St. Mary's Community Centre. The tickets are £5, and I just wanted to highlight what that money is for. I expect you all know about the food bank that Churches Together in Leyland run, that's based at the community centre at St Mary's, and that's very well supported. But another thing that the Churches Together do is they run a furniture scheme. I don't know whether any of you knew about that, but they collect furniture that people no longer want, make it right or do things with it, and then families who need furniture, they will take it to them. And as they say, people are very concerned that people haven't got any food to eat. They're not as concerned that they haven't got a bed to sleep on, which for some people is the reality. Now, furniture, unlike food, isn't that easy to transport, so they have a van, but it's on its last legs. And as you can imagine, a new van costs a lot of money. It also costs a lot of money to keep it running with petrol and insurance and all that sort of thing as well. So this concert is in aid of that. So Peter has the tickets. Peter there. He has the tickets. Good value, £5. He's in the choir as well. So it'd be good to support him. But also, if you've not heard about the furniture scheme, talk to Peter, because he knows what goes on there. And you might feel that you'd like to give a donation of £5, even if you can't make the concert. So that's that one. And then we have bands of marriage. I hope they aren't complicated names, because I haven't looked at them. Is that all the notices? Anybody got anything else? No? Okay. So I published the banns of marriage between Liam Benjamin Kirkham, single of this parish, and Lauren Kate Smith, also single of this parish. If anyone knows any reason This is for the first time of asking if anyone knows of any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other. You are to declare it now. So let's pray for Liam and Lauren. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your most excellent gift of love, which we've just prayed that you would pour into our hearts. And so we pray for Liam and Lauren, that the love that they have for one another will be cemented in this marriage, and that they would find something of your love as well. Amen. We now have our first Bible reading, and Leslie's going to come and bring that to us, and then we're going to sing. So I'll come back.
The first reading is from Matthew chapter 28. Beginning at verse 16. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain, not that mountain, sorry, where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." This is the word of the Lord.
We're going to sing again a song that sort of takes us through the life of Jesus. And after this, the younger people will be going out for their groups. So we sing "From the Squalor of a Borrowed Stable."
Thank you.
As we stand, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would open the eyes of our hearts today, whether we're young or old, whether we're new to faith or have been Christians for a long time. May we all at our own level hear from you today. Amen. So now if our younger people would like to go out, then Leslie's going to come with a second reading and then Sue.
Second reading is from Titus, chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. Doing good for the sake of the gospel. You, however, must teach what is appropriate to sound doctrine. Teach the older men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, and sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. Likewise, teach the older women to be reverent in the way they live, not to be slanderers or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Then they can urge the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, and to be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. Similarly, encourage the young men to be self-controlled. In everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. Teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them, not to talk back to them, and not to steal from them, but to show that they can be fully trusted, so that in every way they will make the teaching about God our Saviour attractive. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Saviour, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. These, then, are the things you should teach. Encourage and rebuke with all authority. And do not let anyone despise you. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's pray. Father God, we praise you for sending your son Jesus to reveal your nature to us, to reveal yourself to us, and more than that, to bring us salvation through his death for us on the cross and his rising again. And Lord, we praise you that though Jesus is no longer physically present with us for this time, that you have poured out upon us the gift of your spirit. And we ask for the help of your spirit now, that by your spirit you would bring to life the words that we read in the Bible and help us to understand how you want us to apply them to our own lives. Amen. So as Barbara said, we're coming to our second mark of mission in this series that we're doing for 5 weeks, looking at five different marks of mission. And we've got these two passages, and I'm going to focus actually on the Titus one, so you're going to have to hold me to this, because I do want to look first at the Matthew one, Matthew 28, but I need to try and do that quickly because I want to focus on Titus. But I'm going to do it because we're looking at teaching, this second mark is about teaching. I thought, right, well, what do teachers do? Teachers often ask questions. So I'm going to ask four questions. I'll give you the first one. You can see if you can guess what the next are going to be. What? Why? Who? And when? Very good. So what is Jesus saying to his disciples as he gathers them, as recorded here right at the end of Matthew's gospel? What is he saying they need to do? So verse 19, Jesus is saying that the task that he's giving to his disciples is to go and make disciples. And that making disciples is made up of two things: baptizing in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And then, well, that's the command. And it's interesting, I remember, I think it was Archdeacon Mark, actually, at an annual meeting years back, talking about this passage, which has since become very much the foundation of our vision here at St. John's. We was talking about the fact that sometimes the emphasis is on the going. And actually, the primary focus of this command is on the making disciples. That in a sense, that the way the translation I've used up there, it's as you go. So wherever you go, whatever you do, our task as followers of Jesus is to make other followers of Jesus, is to make disciples. And it's interesting the way the message... I'll come back to that later. The message puts it differently, but I've kept swapping the order of my slides, so I'm forgetting which way I've put them. In terms of making disciples, so it's interesting that the title in the marks of mission is to teach, baptize, and nurture. And I think in this passage, we've kind of got it a little bit the other way around. I was thinking, well, what's nurture? So I looked up nurture in the dictionary, and it says that to nurture is to care and protect something or someone as it grows. So if you think about nurturing a plant, well, you have to get it planted in the right place to start with, don't you? And I guess maybe that's like the baptism. You kind of have to get it started in the right place. But then if it's going to continue to grow strong and healthy, it needs protecting from the slugs, and it needs watering, and it needs a bit of tending, maybe a bit of pruning here and there, looking after. And it's the same with children, isn't it? Yeah? Well, maybe not quite the same. You don't generally plant them and just leave them. But you kind of, they get started in life. But we don't just sort of get them started and leave them to it, do we? They need a lot of looking after. And in the Christian life, we baptize, and that's your kind of starting in the way. But you don't just, well, hopefully we don't just, we're told that we're not to just tell people about the message of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, baptize them, say, right, now you're a Christian, off you go, get on with it. No, there needs to be that process of teaching and of helping people to grow. And when does that stop? Well, we'll come to that. But I was thinking, there you are, here's the next picture. It reminded me of when you get a new job. Have you ever had a job where you have to wear a uniform? Well, sometimes you have to do a bit of training first before you allow to wear the uniform and have the name badge. But usually, even if you've done a bit of training first, actually, once you do get the uniform on and the name badge, there's usually quite a lot of training still to go, isn't there? Actually, the on-the-job training is the most important thing once you're in the job and you're learning how to do it. And I suspect most of us have probably had the experience at some point in our lives where we've kind of been given a job, we've gone through the application process, we've been accepted whether or not we've had a uniform. And then there's that little bit of, oh my goodness, what am I doing? When it's a new job, at whatever stage of life, there's a lot of learning to do, isn't there, to get your heads around, well, what's involved in this? There's a lot of teaching and training and learning. And actually, one of the best ways of learning is often to learn from others who've been in the job for longer. And so this is where I thought I'd just put up this the message translation of this particular bit of the verse that actually translates the phrase make disciples by saying train everyone in this way of life. It's saying that to be a Christian, it's not just about holding a set of beliefs that we affirm, that we say, yes, I believe this, right, I'm a Christian. It's about, the early followers of Jesus were known as followers of the way. To be a Christian is to be one who follows in the way of Jesus. And that's not something we learn overnight. In fact, no, it's something that we carry on learning, isn't it, through the whole of our lives. What it means to keep walking in the way of Jesus. We need to keep learning, keep training. So that's a little bit about what, and we'll come to that more in Titus. I think the others are quicker. Why? Jesus says, because he has all authority. You can see that there. Can we see that there? No, because I've not put that bit up. In verse 18, if you've got your Bibles on page 1001, in verse 18, Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples. So because Jesus is the one who has all authority, that's why we need to be following his instructions and helping other people to follow his instructions. Because one day we're going to be answering to him. So that's some of the why here. And who? Who is it that's gathering? Well, in the first instance here in Matthew chapter 28, verse 16, it's the 11. There were 12 of them. Judas has betrayed Jesus and has killed himself by now, so there's 11 left. And it's just those 11 disciples at first, Matthew tells us, who were there. But actually, we would acknowledge that these instructions that he gives initially to these 11 are then for all who will follow on after them. Because their task as disciples, learners, followers, is to make other disciples, other learners, other followers. And so actually part of being a disciple is that you're somebody who then disciples others. That's part and parcel of the role. We're not just called to make converts, to make people who say, affirm, yeah, I believe that, but of people who live it. And part of living it is to help others to believe and to live it as well. And even, it's interesting, in verse 17, Barbara emphasized at the start of the service the fact that when they saw Jesus, they worshipped him. But did you notice the other little bit? Some of them, even at that stage, doubted. Don't think, if you have doubts, if you have questions, that that means you're disqualified, that you can't be a disciple. It's actually part and parcel of being a disciple that there's times when we do have questions. That's actually part of learning and growing. And Jesus doesn't say, right, those of you who that are sure about me, you go off and you make disciples. No, he says to all of them, including the ones who've got a few doubts and questions, this is what I want you to do. And actually, maybe as you go and teach others, it'll help you to learn more of me yourself and to become more confident in this faith that you're going to be teaching to others. So that's part of the who. The who is the disciples, the learners. All of us who are disciples of Jesus, followers of Jesus, need to be making disciples of others. The other who is who should we be discipling? And that's where verse 19 is important. Go and make disciples of who? Of all nations, all peoples, all people groups is the actual term that's used. So it's about different nationalities, but it's also about different cultures within one nation. It's about basically everybody. Everybody and anybody who will listen and who will respond. Go and make disciples of all those who respond to this message of Jesus. And again, we'll come to that in Titus. And when? Well, here's the when comes right at the end in Matthew. Teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. So always, forever. to the end of the age, until Jesus comes again. So we're not let off the hook until Jesus comes back. We need to continue in this task. So that's kind of my initial what, why, who, when. And I'm going to go through those same four questions. with the passage from Titus chapter 2, because I've got to confess, and I've got to confess first that I can't remember what's coming next, but I think what's coming next is to actually look at Titus. It'd be really good if you could look at it with me. If you've got the brown Bibles, it's page 1198, 1199, Titus chapter 2. I haven't got the page number if it's in the larger print, but 1856, if you've got the larger print. Thank you, Leslie. I noticed that Leslie had the larger print, well, she'd said anyway, but it's interesting. The larger print Bibles are actually a slightly updated translation of the NIV. So I don't know if you spotted, but there were one or two places, if you were following in this one, that were just very slightly different wording. There we go. I hope it didn't put us off too much. I might refer to it. We'll see. So Titus is actually a letter that's being written by Paul to Titus. And it seems that Paul had, on his travels, as he planted churches around the Mediterranean, we know about Timothy. So the previous two letters were to this young man, Timothy, that he had left in Ephesus in Asia, modern-day Turkey. But he also writes this very short letter to Titus, who it seems he'd left in Crete, where he'd planted a church. And Titus had been left by Paul to build up, to nurture, to disciple the young church in Crete. And this is Paul writing to Titus with some instructions about how to do that, how to go about this business of making disciples. And that's why it's a very good passage for us to begin to look at this morning. I say begin to look at it because actually I'm really hoping those of you that meet in growth groups through the week can look at it in a bit more depth. And for the growth group notes, it's this passage that I've focused on because... I'll try and make sure we're not here all morning. So I'll just be highlighting a few things that you can maybe then think about in more depth. But so as Paul writes to this man, Titus, we don't know very much about him other than what Paul writes to him here. But again, he's trying to help Titus to understand something of this task of making disciples. And what is it that Paul says to him? Well, I wanted us to start right at the start of chapter 2, where Paul says that Titus is to teach what is in accord with sound doctrine, or I think the newer version says what is appropriate to sound doctrine. And that actually kind of implies two aspects to the teaching, a bit like in a job or to train for a job, you might do some kind of classroom learning, some kind of learning that involves reading and understanding what's involved. And so to be a good follower of Jesus, there's a certain amount of understanding the doctrine, the sound or healthy doctrine of who Jesus is, of who God is, of what it means to be his followers. But more than that, Paul says to Titus, you need to teach what is in accord with, what is appropriate to sound doctrine. In other words, if this is what we believe, once we know what we believe about Jesus, we don't just leave it there. As I was saying, I'm kind of repeating myself a bit, but hopefully it's to make the point. We don't just leave it there, yeah, oh, I know that. No, we need to work out, therefore, how should we live? What is it, how is it that we should be living our lives day to day in a way that it agrees with what we believe about God and what he's revealed of himself through Jesus? So there's kind of two aspects to the teaching that he's to do. He's to teach the sound and healthy doctrine, and that word sound comes up a couple of times, and it's about, it can also be translated healthy. If you think a healthy body is one that is well balanced, if you want a healthy diet, you need a good balanced diet. You don't, any one food isn't going to be healthy in itself. You need a balance, don't you? And so there's this idea of balanced teaching. Teaching that isn't just head knowledge, but is lived out in practice. And that's why for most of chapter 2, Titus then goes into quite a bit of detail about how, sorry, Paul goes into quite a bit of detail about how Titus is to teach different groups within the church. And I don't know about you, but I've tended not to look at Titus very much. And I wonder if one of the ways, if I'm really honest with myself, is that some of his language I find a bit off-putting. Did you notice he's talking about these different groups? So there's the older men, and then he talks about the older women, and the older women are to train the younger women, and they're to train the younger women. I'm going to go straight to it, because I realise this is something that I find a bit off-putting, and so I've kind of left it aside a bit, and I shouldn't, because it's really important, I think. They can train the younger women to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home or working at home, to be kind and to be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. Any of you hear that and think, that sounds a bit of an old-fashioned notion? And Christians will differ, actually, as to how much they think this is absolutely where things are today. But I want you to compare that with what it says in verse 9 and 10 about slaves. Because Paul then says to Titus, you're to teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them, not to talk back to them, not to steal from them, but to show they can be trusted. Paul isn't saying, if you're a woman, you've got to be at home, you mustn't ever go out to work, you must only ever sort of live at home under the jurisdiction of your husband, and that's the only way of life as a woman. Any more than I think Paul is saying, if you're a slave, you're always a slave, and slavery's fine, it's just part of how... Yeah, that's another bigger question that I haven't got time to address today. But I think what Paul is saying is, in this society where Titus is living, in this culture, in this context, within his church, there are people who come from what was very normal for the households of his day, where actually there were certain expectations of the women, and the women didn't generally go out, and women and men were quite separate. That was the culture they were living in. And actually within that culture, in most households, there would be household slaves, and the slaves were slaves, and they were bonded to obey their masters, and they had a duty to do what their masters said. And he's not talking about the rights or wrongs of that situation, but he is saying, when you're teaching the women who are in that situation, in that society where society norms are like this, this is how they can live their lives in that situation in a way that brings glory to Jesus, who they are following. And if you are teaching slaves who in that society, that is their position, they are slaves, then this is the best way that Jesus would want them to live as slaves in a way that glorifies him. That is doing what they're doing, not because they have to, not because they'll be whipped if they don't, but actually because they have chosen to follow Jesus. And in order to follow Jesus, if they do their job as slaves really, really well, that will bring glory to him. Do you see what I'm kind of saying? Because to me, I realised it was a bit of a barrier. And actually, the question about, what does it mean for women? I'm not going to try and address that today, because that's far too big a topic. But what I'm saying is that basically, what Paul is saying, that for each person, whatever situation they're in, and whatever society they're in, it matters that believing in Jesus affects how they live in their situation. So one of the things I've suggested you could do if you're in a growth group, and maybe you can do it if you're not in a growth group, but you're thinking more on this passage at home, is, what situation am I in? Or what situation are fellow Christians that I'm supporting, encouraging in? And what might the broad principles that we find here mean for them? Because Paul gives a few examples here that would have been common examples of the kind of people that would have been in the church that Titus was leading. And I think there's probably a bigger variety for the situations that we're in. But whatever situation we're in, it matters that we think through what I believe, how does it affect how I live day to day? And what are the things I can do in the situation that God has placed me that mean I can live in a way that gives most honor to God? Because let's come to the why now. Why does this matter? Well, firstly, in terms of the context of this letter, in the first chapter, Paul has been talking about false teachers, people who are teaching things that are not helpful to living the way of Jesus. And in particular, right at the end of chapter 1, verse 16, he talks about how these teachers claim to know God, but by their actions, they deny him. They're detestable, disobedient, and unfit for doing anything good. So that's the context of chapter 2, is that Titus, in contrast to those false teachers, he's to be somebody who doesn't just claim to know God, but actually lives in a way that brings honour to God, brings honour to the God he claims to believe in. He's to do that himself, and he's to teach and help and nurture and encourage those in his church, in his congregation, to do the same. So we find three times in this chapter references to why he's to do what he does. So So that's a little bit in terms of the, coming back to the uniform idea, coming back to the false teachers. I remember when I was teaching, one of the things that the sort of senior teachers often used to say to the pupils in assembly was, once you're wearing our uniform, you represent our school. And so you need to be careful how you behave when you're wearing our uniform, because what people think of our school will depend on what they see of you as our pupils wearing our uniform. Were you ever told that when you were at school, if you can remember? And actually, you know, looking at the second picture up there, if you see pupils in a particular uniform causing problems or doing vandalism or kicking off on the bus or having a smoke behind the sheds or whatever, or with the tie down near the, you know, it doesn't give a very good impression of them, but it doesn't give a very good impression of the school whose uniform they're wearing. And I guess I use that just as a picture of what I think Titus is saying here about these false teachers. If you're claiming to be a follower of Jesus, it matters how you live day to day, because others will see it and it'll make a difference. It'll make a difference to whether others want to be followers of Jesus too. Because if you're saying, believe the good news of Jesus, if you go out telling people Jesus is good news, and then they turn up and at church or actually they just see you out and about and you're bad-mouthing somebody else, or you're kind of, I don't know, doing things in a mean or unpleasant way. And I think, well, if you're one of the people who goes there, I'm not sure I want to join a group of people that behave like that. Yeah, the way we behave, the way we live, should be saying something about the God we serve, and it matters. So that's kind of what Titus emphasizes again and again through this passage. So when he says all those bits about what the older women to do and what they're to train the younger women to do in verses 4 and 5, notice the reason why. They're to do these things, they're to be self-controlled and pure, work at home, be kind. Why? So that no one will malign the word of God or bring it into disrepute. Within that culture, if as women they'd start to say, oh, well, God set me free, so I don't need to listen to my husband anymore, I can go out and do this. In a culture where that would have been really very shocking, it wouldn't have actually helped the cause of the gospel for them to behave in certain ways. Whereas actually to be women who actively chose not just to be obedient, but to love their husbands, to love their children, to serve them not because they had to, but because they wanted to, because they wanted to show God's love in the way that they loved their families. That would be a really good advert for what it is to be a Christian. So that's the first example. And then he goes on to talk to Titus himself and to say how Titus himself is to set an example particularly to the other young men. So possibly Titus himself may have been quite a young man. We're not sure. But he's to set this good example. Why? Verse 8, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. So having set a good example, which others have followed, people might try and badmouth these Christians, but actually they look at the way they're living and they say, no, actually, they're not getting drunk, they're not causing trouble, actually they're living in ways that help build community, that support those around them in society. Actually, I might want to criticise them, but actually they're living in ways that are quite honourable, quite impressive. So Paul's concern, and then it's again when he says to the slaves, verse 10, that they're to do all these things, not to steal, to show they can be fully trusted, so that in every way they will make the teaching about God our Saviour attractive. And I think that's why this stuff about teaching and making disciples is part of our mission. Because actually, what's Paul's heart here? It's for more, it is for reaching out to see more people brought in to be followers of Jesus. And he's saying, actually, the way you live day to day makes a difference to those around you. Because if others can see in the way that you're living, in the choices that you're making, in the attitude that you're showing, if they can see something of the love and the kindness, of the generosity and the graciousness of the God that you believe in, that will make others who see the way you live want to know more, and want to know more of the God who inspires and enables you to live in that way. So that actually growing as disciples, helping one another to, and nurturing one another to grow in our walk with Jesus, to think through day to day the practicalities of what living out our faith means, that is part of our mission, because that is part of what others see of what these Christians are like. And that's really significant, isn't it, for us? Right, I can't remember what else I had on here, so I'm just going to click on. Oh, there we go. It's kind of part of the how, because that was another question. I didn't include how, did I? We've done what and why. Are we coming on to who? That's it. We'll do it under who. Who should be doing this discipling? I've kind of hinted at it already and said all of us. Who in the first instance? Obviously certain people. And because I think when we think about teaching, we think, oh, well, you know, it'd be easy for those of you sat listening to think, oh, well, I'm not a teacher, so this doesn't apply to me. And in one sense, yes, actually, there are those who are given the task of teaching. And quite scarily, for those of us who do teach, the Bible says elsewhere that those who teach will be judged more strictly, because there are those who are given a particular responsibility and role within the church of teaching. However, making disciples isn't just about teaching, as it were, facts from the front. It's also about the training. And training is about not just do what I say, not what I do. It is the do what I do. It is the setting an example. Because as human beings, we are wired to learn by watching others from our very first days. So a tiny baby, how do they learn? By seeing those around them. So, you know, I love that first picture of the mother and the baby, and the baby's learning to talk by mimicking the mother's actions. And that is how children learn and grow, is by watching those around them, for good or ill. they learn from those around them. And as they grow up, that's the same. Yeah, so that was just a couple of pictures, just by putting in children imitating. I love the toothbrush one. We've failed badly, but anyway, that's another story entirely, hopefully one day. But anyway, we do our best to clean our teeth and hope that our children will follow us, but hey. You know, people don't always follow, but we can do our best in terms of setting an example. And that isn't just the job of the teachers in the church. Actually, that's the job of all disciples, is to be doing what they can to set an example to others. And we see an example of... I'm repeating myself. We see an example of that, I think, again, in these older women in verse 3 and 4. That Titus is to teach the older women particularly to be reverent in the way they live, to be effectively taking God with them so that they bring the presence of God into whatever situation they're in, bringing their maturity, their experience of life. Not being slanderers, not gossiping about people, not whatever, not being addicted to much wine, presumably for some of the older Cretan women, that was a particular danger that some of them were succumbing to. Now they need to resist that. But to be able to teach what is good, to train, I think it used a different word in the newer version, but actually I think this is quite a good translation, to train the younger women by their example and by their teaching. Not because they're specifically chosen as teachers in the church, but just by nature of the fact that in that society, the older women would have that kind of a role in terms of being role models, setting an example for younger women, actually by the way they lived, as well as the advice they could give, They were to teach and to train the younger ones. And actually, that's true of all of us. Whoever we are, whatever our age, there will be people who look to us, whether we realise it or not, and to the example that we set. And it matters. So who is all of us? Because all of us have influence others around us who see how we behave as Christians. And just think of your own life and how you've grown as a Christian. And I know when I think back, so many of the good habits that I've grown into as a Christian, I was very blessed to have Christian parents who set me a really good example. But I also was brought up within a church where there were, you know, I had great youth leaders and there were people in the congregation who loved me and looked out for me. And, you know, coming up through life, one of my two of my youth leaders, a married couple who were my youth leaders as teenagers, I then used to love looking after their children. And even when they moved away, I used to go and stay with them. And I would see how they were with their children. And I know how much I learned from them. Sorry, just getting emotional there. I need to move on because we've spent too long on that. And I'm not doing well at... I'm going to whip through that bit because I've probably gone on too long already. But the when was the last question, which is kind of at the end of chapter 2, having talked about all these things. Paul says to Titus something of why, again, he should teach all these things, why people should be living in this way. And it does the why in terms of when we're living. The fact that we're living in between two appearings or epiphanies is the Greek word. That's what I put there. This is just looking at verses 11 to 14 of chapter 2 of Titus. That we're living in between Jesus' appearing. When he, at his first coming, verse 11, the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared in the past. And then verse 13, we're waiting for the blessed hope, the hope of blessing, the appearing in glory of our great God and Saviour, Jesus Christ. And so we're kind of, when we're living, when we're to be making disciples, is basically, as we said before, looking back to when Jesus first came and the grace that he brought then, and looking ahead to the fact that he's coming again. And just in terms of our motivation, that was something that really struck me in this. Why should we want to live self-controlled lives? There's so many things I could have brought to this today, and I've run out of time, but notice how self-control comes up and again in every different group that Paul is urging Titus to teach. To each one of them, he says about the importance of self-control. But in terms of saying why this self-control is important, why we should want to live pure and holy lives, it's because when Jesus first came, just look at verse 14, which I think kind of sums it up for me. Jesus, when he first came, gave himself for us. That's his grace. That's the undeserved gift of God, that Jesus gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. That's what Jesus has done in the past. He's come not just to, well, he's come to bring us back to God, to purify us, so that having believed, we then want to live in a way that pleases him. And we want to do that because we're looking ahead to when he will appear again, to when he will come back and bring to himself this people that he has purified, that he has made ready to be with him, to be with God in glory. And as we look forward to that appearing that is to come when Jesus comes back in glory, that's what should motivate us for ourselves to want to be living lives that are fitting, are appropriate as his people, but also what should motivate us to want to make disciples of others, to encourage and help others to grow, to come to faith in Jesus in the first place, but then to keep growing, to keep learning what it is to live for him, so that they with us can be part of this people that Jesus is going to call to himself, and who will share in his glory when he comes again. So as we reflect further on this passage through the week, I pray that God, by his Spirit, would set our hearts on fire afresh with that desire to be those who are disciples ourselves, are growing in learning to live out our faith. But as we do that, are helping others to become disciples too and to grow in living for him. Amen.
The next song that we're going to sing is one that's very appropriate for me in my secondary school back in the 1960s. Schools were very different. Even though it wasn't a church school, it had a very strong Christian ethos. And every Monday at the end of assembly, we would sing one of two hymns. And one of them was this one. We sang the first and the third verse as we were leaving the hall to go about our week's learning in school. Forth in thy name I go, my daily labour to pursue thee, only thee, resolved to know. I know the language is old-fashioned, but the sentiment is really key for us today. So we stand to sing, forth in thy name, O Lord, I go. Standing for the creed, which today we're going to sing. We haven't sung this one for a long time, but it's the words of the creed, what we believe, set to music. So these are the facts as we have received them. please sit as we pray. In our cycle of prayers this week, we are praying for the work of compassion. The Monday afternoon growth group, through sponsorship prayer and messages of encouragement, have been supporting since 2007 to the present day Sammy and his family who live in Haiti, one of the poorest countries in the world. Sammy will be 22 next year and his sponsorship will come to an end, but we are thankful that through compassion and their sponsorship, Sammy has come to know and love the Lord Jesus, has been schooled, has learnt skills that are and will help him in the future, and Sammy and his family have been helped with things like buying and rearing pigs and goats, which have also benefited their community. So we thank God for the work of compassion. Dear Father, how many people are suffering in this world? How many children and their families are living in a vulnerable way? It hurts our heart to know that when they sit at the table or on the dirt floor, they can only look at the sky because they have nothing to eat. It hurts our hearts to know that unemployment and lack of opportunities close the door to the possibility of at least eating a loaf of bread. We pray, God, that you would continue to use compassion, church partners, donors, and sponsors to continue to bless these children and their families. Amen. We bring before God Mark and all the other ordinands who will be ordained on Saturday. God, our Father, Lord of all the world, through your Son, you have called us into the fellowship of your universal church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry, each may be an instrument of your love. Give to your servants about to be ordained the needful gifts of grace. And we ask these things through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. O God, King of kings and Lord of lords, we pray today for statesmen, leaders, and rulers. May they be quiet in spirit and clear in judgment. May they be able to understand the issues that face them. May they think often of the common people on whose behalf they must speak and act. May they remember that in keeping your laws is man's only good and happiness. Grant them patience. Grant them courage. Grant them foresight and great faith. In their anxieties, be their security. In their opportunities, be their inspiration. By their plans and their actions, may your kingdom come, your will be done. Amen. Mazzy was supposed to be coming and helping with prayers this morning, but she's not well, so we pray for all those who are sick in mind, body, and spirit. We remember especially Mazzy and Mozzie. We remember Jim as he begins his radiotherapy this week. And for Gloria with her ongoing difficulties. And there are so many others known to us, and we name them in our hearts before God. Please, Lord, bring them peace in their pain, your strength in their weakness, and your comfort in their sadness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we join our prayers together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our final hymn makes life seem like a dance. And so it's asking God to help us to dance in tune, in line with what he would have us be doing in our daily lives. So teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. If you feel like doing a few steps, then please do. Because the tune sort of, when you hear it, encourages you to move around a bit.
Do please just take a seat. I'm butting in. I'm taking my prerogative as a vicar. Sorry about that. But just before we go, I do just want to just say a few words that were brought to me really by what was being shared. I'm so grateful here to be part of a leadership team. I'm so grateful for the blessing of the many people who serve here, particularly for those who assist with the leading of worship and with the preaching and the teaching, who pour out so much to serve us. And in particular, I've been incredibly blessed by the leadership of Barbara and the preaching of Sue today for all that they've put in to serve us, to teach us, and to help us in our mission. And I was particularly helped by what Sue was sharing today from Titus. And I think she brought out such helpful things that I just wanted to reiterate them. so that we do not lose them or miss what was said. Because we were being encouraged to conduct ourselves in a temperate way, in a way that's worthy of respect, in a way that's self-controlled, in the way that we act, and in the way that we speak to one another and about one another, to act in a way that is kind and that is pure. And that doesn't only start when we go out. That's how we act here with one another. And I'm so blessed that that is so often what I experience here at St. John's. And so I just want to encourage us again that that is what we're being called to do, to be kind to one another, to speak to one another and of one another in a self-controlled and a respectful way. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the Spirit of Jesus in us. Thank you that you are calling us and transforming us to be like Jesus. And I pray that you would help us to do that. Help us as a family to love one another well, to speak to and of one another well, to respect one another well, to build one another up. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
And now may the love of the Lord Jesus draw us to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. The joy of the Lord Jesus fill our hearts. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen.